So when it comes to antifungal drugs, they are the medicines that are used in the treatment of various mycoses, right? The fungal infections of the skin, they are very common and they are known to affect almost 1 billion people. So that means that there are a lot many people who are being infected with fungal infections. And as I said earlier, because the fungal infections, they can be anyway causing cosmetic infections to life-threatening infections. And if the infection is cosmetic infection, then there are some people who are not taking this into consideration. They are not considering about the treatment of the fungal infection because it is just a simple thing and they think that it will go away, right? And it does not cause that big a trouble. That's why people are reluctant to treat it very soon. They are reluctant to seek treatment very soon. So there are very high number of people who are being affected with the disease. So let's have a look at various drugs. The azole antifungals, right? As I said earlier, they are divided into imidazoles and triazoles, right? Imidazoles being the two nitrogen containing azoles and triazoles containing the three nitrogen containing azoles. Okay, then there is in imidazoles, there is clotrimazole, miconazole, ketoconazole, and the relatively new drug, laliconazole. In triazoles, there is fluconazole, itraconazole, voriconazole, posaconazole, and albuconazole. Then there are pollen antifungals. These are the antifungal antibiotics obtained from Streptomyces. They are amphotericin B and nystatin. The pollen antifungals, they bind to ergosterol and form pores in them, causing leakage of the cellular content and thereby death of the fungal cell. While the antifungal drug azoles, they inhibit the lanosterol 14 alpha dimethylase enzyme, which converts lanosterol to ergosterol. Again, there are another class of drugs called allyl amines, like terbinafine and naftifine. These are known to inhibit squalene epoxidase, and this results in concentration of squalene in the fungal cells. And again, this squalene, when concentrated in high amounts, this causes death of the fungal cells. This is also something that is involved in the synthesis of ergosterol itself. Then there are echinocandins like caspofungin, micafungin, and anidulafungin. They inhibit the cell wall synthesis by inhibiting 1,3 beta glucan synthesis. Gracilfulvin, flucytosin, sortirin, cyclopyrox. These are also different classes of drugs that belong to different groups. Gracilfulvin is known to inhibit the microtubule assembly. Flucytosin, it inhibits the DNA and RNA synthesis. Similarly, sortirin, it inhibits protein synthesis, and cyclopyrox, it inhibits the precursor of macromolecular synthesis, which is required, which is involved in cell membrane. So there will be leakage of the intracellular contents again. These are the various antifungal drugs, right? So let us have a look out here. This being the fungal cell, right? You can see that inhibition of DNA synthesis is happening by flucytosin. Then there are another classes of drugs called inhibitors of HSP90 or HSOC protein 90. These are not so much widespread in use so far. They are being used in very few places, like in for study purpose, and it has not been used outside that. There are drugs which are known to cause production of ROS or reactive oxygen species, reactive nitrogen species, and for cell death, like amphotericin B is one of them. And miconazole, cyclopyrox are also others. There are others which cause problem with microtubules assembly, like gracilfulvin. And there are others which cause problem with inhibition of protein synthesis, like sortirin. Okay. Among these, you can see that amphotericin B, gracilfulvin, and flucytosin. These two are relatively used more, right? Miconazole, amphotericin, and gracilfulvin. Apart from this, flucytosin is relatively lesser used, and this is used only in certain cases with amphotericin B, and other drugs, they are not so much widespread in use. So let us have a look at this slide. Okay, here you can see that there are echinocandins, which are inhibitors of beta glucan synthesis, right? These are relatively new class of antifungal drugs that came in. They are not so new, however, in that caspofungin was identified in 2001. And micafungin and anadulafungin in 2005 and 11, I believe. Okay, then there are certain drugs called chitin inhibitors, which is called inhibition of chitins. These were identified pretty long before, but then they did not come into clinical use. And it was in the interest in nicomycin, and nicomycin, it started recently again. there are certain drugs that bind to ergosterol itself, right? Like folines, the amine amphotericin B itself, right? This is quite important, the amphotericin B, and others, they are not so important. Then there are 14 alpha demethylase inhibitors, or the azoles. Azoles are very much in use. Then there are drugs which cause inhibition of squalene epoxidase, terbinafine and naftifin. So you can see that there are lot many drugs that actually stop the synthesis of ergosterol, right? One, the azoles, sorry. Second, the squalene epoxidase inhibitors. And again, there are certain drugs that directly bind to ergosterol, form pores in them, and then cause the death of the cell, fungal cells like amphotericin B, the folines. So there are more drugs that are being used of this category as compared to the earlier slide one. Hello everyone. Welcome to today's lecture on antifungal agents with me, Sanjay Dekhil. So let us look into the contents that we'll be discussing today. Okay, firstly, when we think of antifungal agents, what are the drugs that come to your mind? So it may be the azoles, right? Like fluconazole, clotrimazole, ketoconazole, itraconazole. Then there may be either amphotericin B or nystatin, which fall into the group of folines. Then there are drugs like micafungin and caspofungin, which are echinocandins. Then there are terbinafine and tolenaptate-like allyl amines. And there may be other drugs like rifampicin and flucytosin. So let us look into the contents that we'll be discussing today, right? So we'll be looking at different fungal infections. Yeah, as you said, this is mostly dealt in microbiology, so we'll not be dealing with fungal infections in very much detail, but nevertheless, we'll look into different kinds of fungal infections, right? And we'll also look into fungal infections that are prevalent in Nepal. We'll look into the antifungal drugs. We'll also look into the mechanisms that are involved, the classification of antifungal drugs, and then we'll move on lastly in individual drugs and classes, okay? When we talk about individual drugs, we'll start with folines, amphotericin B, and nystatin. Amphotericin B is one of the most toxic drugs that is ever known from the antibiotic class. Okay, so this is one of the very toxic drugs. And nystatin is even more toxic than amphotericin, but nevertheless, nystatin is only used topically. That's why, since it is not given IV like amphotericin B, the toxicity is relatively low. The azoles are there. Fluconazole is one of the mostly used drugs when it comes to antifungal drugs, antifungal azoles, or all the category of antifungal drugs. Fluconazole is one of the mostly used ones. Then clotrimazole and ketoconazole. Ketoconazole was first. Clotrimazole is still used as a topical antifungal cream, right? It also comes as powder. Ketoconazole, earlier it was identified as a oral antifungal drug, but then from 2001 onwards, they found that it causes hepatotoxicity, and there are other associated toxicities as well. That's why the use of ketoconazole orally, it has been discontinued in many places. Nevertheless, we still are able to find ketoconazole in oral formulations here in Nepal. Okay, terbinafine, rifampicin, two others, right? Terbinafine is mostly used in case of onychomycosis. Onychomycosis refers to the nail infections, right? Onychomycosis is nail infections, right? People often have infections in the nail, and it requires almost a year-long therapy to get rid of nail infections. And terbinafine is used mostly in case of nail infections. Onychophagia, the another term, is used for those people who are often used to biting the nails, right? Often we are taking classes and then people are there biting the nails. That's called onychophagia, okay? Okay, and there's another drug called rifampicin. Rifampicin is used basically for skin infections, right? Skin antifungal infections, even the infections of the hair and nails, it can be used. And then we'll be talking about the newer antifungal drugs that have come into use. Okay. Okay, so when it comes to fungal infections, what we can see is that the fungal infections have increased dramatically in the recent years, right? And there is increase in both the incidence as well as severity of the infections. Earlier, fungal infections were not this common, right? But nevertheless, nowadays, the incidence of fungal infections has increased very much. And the last extent of fungal infections are iatrogenic or doctor-induced or nosocomial infections, right? The reason that fungal infections are increasing is because of the advances in surgery. Earlier, there were not many kind of surgeries that were, they were happening, right? But nevertheless, now with many surgeries happening, you give different antibiotics, and then we had talked about superinfection when we were talking back talking about antibiotics, right? When you give broad spectrum antibiotics, there is a chance that there will be infections of different kinds, superinfections of different kind, and fungal infection can also be a kind of superinfection. There are also indwelling catheters and implants that are being increasingly used, right? If some catheters, they can be placed like urinary catheters, right? They can be placed and left in situ for almost 6 months. People don't live it that long, right? But nevertheless, they can be placed and left there for pretty long time. And even implants, there can be different types of implants, orthopedic implants to the different kinds of implants that are being used. So all these things are causing a rise in fungal infections. Another thing is cancer treatment. With cancer treatment, the anti-cancer drugs, they also can lead to decreased immune response, right? And that can lead to fungal infections. Similarly, the increase in broad spectrum antimicrobials, as we discussed when talking about the advances in surgery, right? Because of broad spectrum antimicrobials, we are going to clear the normal flora out of the body, right? And because the normal flora gets dissolved, there can be increasing infection from bacteria and fungus growth. So even the fungal infections have risen, and the HIV epidemic, right? Because of the HIV epidemic, there is fungal infection that is increasing. There are cryptococcus and various other diseases, pneumocystis carinii infections, and there are a lot many other infections that happen in AIDS patients. Okay, if we look into the various fungal infections, we see that there are five major classification of mycoses that happen, right? Superficial ones, the cutaneous ones, the subcutaneous ones, the systemic ones, and the opportunistic ones, right? And the symptoms of fungal infections, they can be anywhere from cosmetic to life-threatening. Some can just be cosmetic in that the one like ringworm. Yeah, it is going to cause some kind of irritation and people will feel like itching, right? But nevertheless, it is not that problematic. So in some cases, you can see that the ringworm might have spread pretty much, in that people do not pay much attention to it. But nevertheless, it has got cosmetic value, right? If it comes in face, especially in girls, right, then they are going to seek help very fast. But in some case, if it is going to affect on toenails or something, there are very few male people who are bothered with the fungal infection of the toenail. So you see that the infection has become very, very worse in some of the cases. And in some cases, like aspergillosis, histoplasmosis, right, it can be life-threatening as well. The systemic and opportunistic infections, they can be life-threatening at certain points. Like bacteremia, when we call it, right, bacterial sepsis, there can be candidemia as well, when the candida can be seen flowing freely flowing in the blood, and that can lead to fungal sepsis as well. Okay, the fungal infections are more difficult to treat than bacterial infections. Why so? Because the fungal organisms, they grow very, very slowly. The rate at which they grow is very slow, right? And the fungal infections, they occur in tissue that are poorly penetrated by the drugs, like devitalized or avascular tissues, right? We said that the fungal, we just saw in the earlier slide, right? That fungal infections, they happen in the hair with tinea capitis, right? They happen in the nail, like onychomycosis. So these are relatively difficult to treat in that they are poorly penetrated by the drugs. And again, there are very few pathogen-specific targets, because fungal cells, they mimic somehow with the mammalian cells, right? They are somehow similar. That's why they become relatively difficult to treat. Okay, have a look at the different infections that happen. Over here, the first three cases, they are the cases of oral thrush, right? Oral candidiasis. This is the case of tinea capitis. Again, this is the case of ringworm. This is the case of athlete's foot. And this is of onychomycosis. Then, again, there's another common fungal infection that happens in women, right? The fungal infection in the vagina, right? Vaginal candidiasis. And this is the case of aspergillosis or aspergilloma. Okay, have a look at this chart. This chart shows the estimated burden of serious fungal infections in Nepal, right? We can see that out here, the infection that occurs the most is fungal keratitis, right? Then there is severe asthma with fungal sensitization. Then there is acute bronchopulmonary aspergillosis and chronic pulmonary aspergillosis. These four are relatively common in Nepal. And then besides this, there is cryptococcal meningitis, pneumocystis pneumonia, and invasive aspergillosis and allergic fungal rhinosinusitis. So these are the various fungal infections that were found in Nepal. What is said is that it affects around 1.94% of the Nepalese population annually, right? And the most serious fungal infections, they occur in HIV/AIDS and in immunocompromised patients. Both pathogenic and allergenic fungi, including Aspergillus species, they are commonly found in the Kathmandu Valley air, right? And as we saw, fungal keratitis is the most prevalent form of fungal infection, and there is also high burden of acute bronchopulmonary aspergillosis and chronic pulmonary aspergillosis. Okay, have a look at this chart. This chart shows the timeline of systemic antifungal agents. This is relatively old, and there are a few drugs that I mentioned here. We'll also be looking at another chart shortly. What you can see is that the drug among the systemically used antifungal drugs, right? Amphotericin B is the first drug that was identified, and then Ricefulvin came shortly afterwards, right? In 1958, amphotericin B was discovered, and then in 1959, there was the discovery of Ricefulvin. Then slowly after 1970, there are lots of drugs that were discovered, right? This is here, why? Because it was only in 1970 that scientists all over the world, they started looking for antifungal drugs that are better, in that amphotericin B has a very, very high toxicity, it being a systemic antifungal agent, right? And Ricefulvin is only used for skin, hair, and nail infections. It can't be used for other kind of infections, systemic infections, right? So they needed another newer kind of agents. That's why in 1970, they started screening a lot many drugs for antifungal activity, and then they found out newer drugs. It was only after the discovery of fluconazole that relatively safe kind of systemic antifungal agent was found, right? Later on, itraconazole, voriconazole, and posaconazole, they were identified, which is relatively better. Again, from 1995 to 1999, lipid amphotericin B formulations were discovered. Because amphotericin B is very, very toxic in the human kidneys, right? Lipid amphotericin B formulation, they are said to spare the kidney toxicity to some extent when using low doses. Nevertheless, if we start using them even in high doses, then the kidneys, sparing of the kidney will be less and lesser. Okay, have a look at this chart. The earlier picture was till 2010, right? Here we can see that this is here till 2020 itself. And like new drugs, they have been found as well. And even like sordarin and nicomycin like drugs, which were earlier identified long earlier, right? The sordarin was a drug that was identified in 1969. However, it was not tried when the scientists were looking for the newer antifungal drugs back in 1970. They did not look for sordarin, and even nicomycin, they didn't think that it is going to be that useful. This is a chitin inhibitor, and this is protein synthesis inhibitor. They thought that this is not going to be that useful when it comes to treatment of fungal diseases. But nevertheless, later on, they found that in the recent years, they found that this is going to be useful, and they discovered this. They started using this as antifungal agent. Okay, the most recent thing that we've got is vaccine against Candida as well. The Candida vaccine was introduced before a few years only. Okay, so these are the various drugs that have been found. So let us have a look in a serial manner, right? The introduction of amphotericin B deoxycholate was there in 1958, right? And it became the standard treatment for serious fungal infections. However, it had infusion-related side effects, because it causes release of TNF and interleukins, right? So it causes rigor, chills, fever, all these infusion-related side effects, thrombophlebitis, and again, there is dose-related nephrotoxicity. So when these are used in high dose, they can cause dose-related nephrotoxicity. Then came the introduction of fluconazole, right? In 1990, this had excellent oral bioavailability, and fluconazole, even now, it's one of the most widely prescribed antifungal agents for both mucosal and systemic yeast infections. However, the problem with fluconazole is that it lacks activity against the opportunistic molds. When we see opportunistic molds, these are the agents that cause infections in AIDS patients and immunocompromised patients, right? Like Aspergillus, mucorales, and Fusarium species. And also, there is intrinsic resistance against some Candida species like Candida krusei and Candida glabrata. Okay. Then came itraconazole in 1992. This had improved activity against endemic fungi and Aspergillus species. However, there was one problem with oral dosing formulation in that there was erratic absorption and it had adverse GI effects. So this was another problem. So again, still later, oriconazole was discovered in 2002 and posaconazole in 2006. Let's not use the term discovered. It was like it became FDA registered in 2002 and 2006 and became widely acceptable, widely available throughout the world. Right? And they managed the transformed the management of the invasive mold infections in severely immunocompromised patients. However, the broad spectrum of the triazole antifungal agents, they come at the expense of increased pharmacokinetic variability and risk of drug interactions. When we say pharmacokinetic variability, there may be differences in absorption, differences in distribution, metabolism, elimination, all those things. Generally, there's less difference in distribution, but however, there's high variability when it comes to absorption, metabolism, and the excretion of the drugs. And also, the chance of drug interactions is relatively high. In that, azoles, they are basically known to inhibit the 14-alpha-dimethylase enzyme, which is required in lanosterol synthesis, right? And this very enzyme is quite similar to the cytochrome P450 enzyme. So this being very much similar to cytochrome P450 enzyme, it also inhibits the cytochrome P450. This inhibition of cytochrome P450 enzymes in humans is seen more with imidazoles as compared to triazoles. We have used the term triazole out here and imidazole, right? The drug we talked about earlier, clotrimazole and ketoconazole, they are imidazoles, while fluconazole, itraconazole, voriconazole, posaconazole, they are all triazoles. Imidazole and triazole, they are separated on the basis of their chemical structure. Imidazole is 2-nitrogen containing azole ring. Triazole contains 3-nitrogen atoms in the ring. That's why we call it a triazole. Okay, even now, there is no single antifungal agent which is appropriate for all the patients of a given mycosis because, one, there is patient-specific comorbid conditions. There are a lot many patients who suffer from different comorbid conditions, and then you can't use one antifungal agent against all the infections, right? That is one reason. The another thing is because of different kind of hypersensitivities in the patients. The another is risk of drug interactions. We just said earlier with in the case of azoles that the case of drug interactions is very high, right? In the case of amphotericin B, we mentioned that it causes high nephrotoxicity, right? And in case of immunosuppressed patients, right, we are not going to use any single antifungal agent. It also depends upon the site of infection and the risk of infection with more intrinsically antifungal resistant pathogens. Okay, have a look at this chart. So when it comes to antifungal drugs, they are the medicines that are used in the treatment of various mycoses, right? The fungal infections of the skin, they are very common and they are known to affect almost 1 billion people. So that means that there are a lot many people who are being infected with fungal infections. And as I said earlier, because the fungal infections, they can be anyway causing cosmetic infections to life-threatening infections. And if the infection is cosmetic infection, then there are some people who are not taking this into consideration. They are not considering about the treatment of the fungal infection because it is just a simple thing and they think that it will go away, right? And it does not cause that bigger trouble. That's why people are reluctant to treat it very soon. They are reluctant to seek treatment very soon. So there are very high number of people who are being affected with the disease. So let's have a look at various drugs. The azole antifungals, right? As I said earlier, they are divided into imidazoles and triazoles, right? Imidazoles being the 2-nitrogen containing azoles and triazoles containing the 3-nitrogen containing azoles. Okay. Then there is, in imidazoles, there is clotrimazole, miconazole, ketoconazole, and the relatively new drug, laliconazole. In triazoles, there is fluconazole, itraconazole, voriconazole, posaconazole, and albuconazole. Then there are pollen antifungals. These are the antifungal antibiotics obtained from Streptomyces. They are amphotericin B and nystatin. The pollen antifungals, they bind to ergosterol and form pores in them, causing leakage of the cellular content and thereby death of the fungal cell. While the antifungal drug azoles, they inhibit the lanosterol 14 alpha dimethylase enzyme, which converts lanosterol to ergosterol. Again, there are another class of drugs called allyl amines, like terbinafine and naftifine. These are known to inhibit squalene epoxidase, and this results in concentration of squalene in the fungal cells. And again, this squalene, when concentrated in high amounts, this causes death of the fungal cells. This is also something that is involved in the synthesis of ergosterol itself. Then there are echinocandins like caspofungin, micafungin, and anidulafungin. They inhibit the cell wall synthesis by inhibiting 1,3-beta-glucan synthesis. Gracilfulvin, flucytosine, sortilin, cyclopyrox, these are also different classes of drugs that belong to different groups. Gracilfulvin is known to inhibit the microtubule assembly. Flucytosine, it inhibits the DNA and RNA synthesis. Similarly, sortilin, it inhibits protein synthesis, and cyclopyrox, it inhibits the precursor of macromolecular synthesis, which is required, which is involved in cell membrane. So there will be leakage of the intracellular contents again. These are the various antifungal drugs, right? So let us have a look out here. This being the fungal cell, right? You can see that inhibition of DNA synthesis is happening by flucytosine. Then there are another classes of drugs called inhibitors of HSP90 or HSOC protein 90. These are not so much widespread in use so far. They are being used in very few places, like in for study purpose, and it has not been used outside that. There are drugs which are known to cause production of ROS, or reactive oxygen species, reactive nitrogen species, and for cell death, like amphotericin B is one of them, and miconazole, cyclopyrox are also others. There are others which cause problem with microtubules assembly, like gracilfulvin, and there are others which cause problem with inhibition of protein synthesis, like sortilin. Okay. Among these, you can see that amphotericin B, gracilfulvin, and flucytosine, these two are relatively used more, right? Miconazole, amphotericin, and gracilfulvin. Apart from this, flucytosine is relatively lesser used, and this is used only in certain cases with amphotericin B. And other drugs, they are not so much widespread in use. So let us have a look at this slide. Okay, here you can see that there are echinocandins, which are inhibitors of beta-glucan synthesis, right? These are relatively new class of antifungal drugs that came in. They are not so new, however, in that caspofungin was identified in 2001, and micafungin and anadulafungin in 2005 and 11, I believe. Okay, then there are certain drugs called chitin inhibitors, which is called inhibition of chitins. These were identified pretty long before, but then they did not come into clinical use, and it was in the interest in nicomycin, it started recently again. There are certain drugs that bind to ergosterol itself, right? Like polines, the amphotericin B itself, right? This is quite important, the amphotericin B, and others, they are not so important. Then there are 14 alpha dimethylase inhibitors, or the azoles. Azoles are very much in use. Then there are drugs which cause inhibition of squalene epoxidase, terbinafine and naftifine. So you can see that there are many drugs that actually stop the synthesis of ergosterol, right? One, the azoles, Second, the squalene epoxidase inhibitors. And again, there are certain drugs that directly bind to ergosterol, form pores in them, and then cause the death of the fungal cells, like amphotericin B, the polines. So there are more drugs that are being used of this category as compared to the earlier slide one. So when we look into the classification of antifungal agents, we can classify them based on the side of action, like systemic antifungal agents and the topical antifungal agents, right? So we had seen about the whole timeline of the systemic antifungal agents that were discovered. This has already been discussed. Now the topical antifungal agents, the imidazoles and triazoles, they both can be topical antifungal agents, right? Then apart from that, in polines, we said that nystatin, despite being of the same group as amphotericin B, it is more toxic than amphotericin B when used systemically. That is why it is used as topical only. And allyl amines, tolactate and naftifine, they are used in onychomycosis or nail infections. based on the mechanism of action, we can see that there are the cells that alter the cell membrane permeability. In that, all of these, they affect the synthesis, they affect the ergosterol. While we humans have cholesterol in our cell membrane, fungal cell membrane, they have got ergosterol in them, right? So the azoles, terbinafine, and polyene, they all interfere with cell membrane permeability. The ones that block the nucleic acid synthesis are flucytosine and graceful fulvin are the ones that disrupt the microtubule function. Let's start with the targets of antifungal drugs. When we say target, target means targets are generally identified before a drug is, while doing research on a certain drug. First, what they do, what the researchers do is they try to identify different targets where they can hit in order to make that drug, in order to discover the drug. We say targets, they are just the mechanism of action of the drug itself, but then they are identified while the drug is still in the discovery phase as to where do we hit in order to get an antifungal drug. And these become the targets, like flucytosine, it inhibited the DNA synthesis, right? Terbinafine, again, it inhibited the conversion of squalene into squalene epoxide. So these are the same things, just it is given in a different manner. Have a look at this picture also. The drugs that act on cell membrane, they are the azoles, polyenes, and allyl amines. We talked about it earlier as well. The drugs that act at the level of cell wall, they are echinocandins, beta-1,3-D glucan synthesis inhibitors. The drugs that act at intracellular level are pyrimidine analogs like flucytosine and mitotic inhibitor like graceofulvin. We're talking about the target of antifungal drugs. We said that there is a difference of the fungal cell as compared to the human cells or the mammalian cells, right? In that they have cell wall in them, however they are metabolically similar to mammalian cells, and then they offer very few pathogen specific targets. That is why the fungal infections, they are relatively difficult to treat as compared to the bacterial infections, in that we don't, like, organism specific toxicity is going to be less with antifungal drugs as compared to the antibacterial drugs. In case of antibacterial drugs, it was easy to find drugs that has organism specific toxicity, causing selective toxicity to the microbes and less toxicity to the humans. But in case of antifungal drugs, the drugs, when they are toxic to the fungal cells, they are also side by side toxic to the humans or the mammals. That's why this is causing a relative problem with antifungal drugs. The azoles, the polyene antifungals, and even the allyl amines, they exert their antifungal effect by targeting ergosterol, right, which is the principal membrane sterol in many pathogenic fungi. Now let us talk about azoles, right? Azoles, they are known to inhibit the 14-alpha-demethylase or the lanosterol demethylase enzyme, which is like fungal cytochrome P450 enzyme, a dependent enzyme. And because of this similarity of this enzyme with human CYP450 enzyme, there will be collateral inhibition of human CYP450 enzymes as well when we use azoles. And that is more common with imidazoles as compared to triazoles. They are known to deplete the cell membrane ergosterol. They increase the membrane fluidity and lead to the accumulation of toxic 14-alpha-methylated sterols, resulting in growth arrest and eventual fungal cell death. Okay. Then another group called allyl amine, right? Of which terbinafine is an example. The allyl amine terbinafine, it inhibits ergosterol biosynthesis by inhibiting squalene monooxidase, an enzyme in the fungi that is responsible for the conversion of squalene to squalene epoxidase, and this is a precursor of lanosterol in ergosterol synthesis pathway. So, though allyl amines, they do not seem to have same collateral effect on human CYP enzymes as the azole antifungal agents. But however, if a drug like rifampicin, which strongly induces CYP metabolism, is given, then it will increase the metabolism of terbinafine as well. And this is taken orally, and then this concentrates itself in the skin and nail beds, and relatively low concentration is found in the bloodstream. So because this concentrates itself in the skin and nail beds, it is easy to treat the skin and nail infection with terbinafine. and therefore its use as systemic antifungal agent is primarily restricted to the treatment of onychomycosis and cutaneous fungal infections only. Then there is amphotericin B. When we discussed earlier, we said that this is one of the first drugs that was discovered for systemic as systemic antifungal agent, right? So the broad this is a broad spectrum polyene drug, amphotericin B, that targets the fungal cell membrane. Amphotericin B directly binds to ergosterol. It forms the complexes that intercalate the cell membrane and result in pore formation. There is leakage of intracellular contents, and amphotericin B, it has relatively greater affinity for ergosterol-rich fungal cell membranes as compared to cholesterol-rich mammalian cell membranes. But however, the specificity will be lost when the drug accumulates in high concentration, and the drug accumulates in high concentration in the kidneys. That is why there is direct damage to the distal tubular membranes, causing high nephrotoxicity. So nephrotoxicity is the dose-limiting adverse effect of amphotericin B therapy. It also directly stimulates the release of pro-inflammatory cytokines like TNF-alpha and interleukins by mononuclear phagocytic cells, thereby resulting in fever, rigor, and chills during the drug infusion. So they are called infusion-related drug reactions, right? And they can be attenuated to varying degree by reformulation of amphotericin B into lipid carriers. We had seen that amphotericin B was discovered back in 1958, and then they were reformulated in lipid carriers in 1995 onwards. However, the principal advantage of lipid amphotericin B is that they are reduced redistribution of amphotericin B in the kidneys, but it still does not eliminate the nephrotoxicity of amphotericin B, it only reduces them. They are semi-synthetic lipopeptides, and they inhibit the synthesis of beta-1,3 glucan synthesis in susceptible fungi, and it leads to the damage of the fungal cell wall. So, and because like we mammals do not have cell wall, right? There is relatively selective toxicity that happens in echinocandins. Echinocandins, they still lack activity against opportunistic yeasts and yeast like Cryptococcus species and less common molds like Fusarium, Mucorals. So these are still seen in severely immunocompromised patients.